I'm going to take our text this morning from the prophet Joel, chapter number 3. And then we will refer to our text for this series, Go and Grow, from Isaiah chapter 2. And then we will begin our dialogue. Before I do that, I wanted to say, I understand someone told me that it's Drea's birthday today. Drea, happy birthday to you. Bless you. You and Mike, y'all are good people. And we say happy birthday to you. And also, all the way, no one has traveled further to be in church today than the people I'm about to introduce to you. Mickey is here all the way from the Netherlands today. And she brought her daughter with her. Clap your hands, everyone, and let them know how much you're glad to see them. How long are you ladies here? How long are you going to be in the city? To next Sunday? Or you have a lot of meals waiting on you? Because these people can't wait to take you to eat and to the Alamo so you can meet Davy Crockett and those guys. Sam Houston and whatnot. But we're glad you're here. And then second, I want to invite all of you to our Tuesday night service. Man, we've been having move of God on Tuesday night. Now, I'm going to be teaching and preaching and prophesying and all that stuff on Tuesday night. And we're going to have just a powerful move of God in this building on Tuesday night. And the service starts at 7:15. And I want to invite you all. I've been on a little vacation the last few weekends, relaxing, reflecting, and fishing in the pond in front of my brother's house in Louisiana. I had Julius, my grandson, over there, and he caught his first fish. And his eyes were big like silver dollars. It looked like the fish was only this big. You would have thought he caught Shamu. He was so happy. And then I got home, and Dustin brought Paxton over, and I was telling the church this morning, I've got a big playground at my house that we had installed for all my grandchildren. It's huge. And Paxton had never been able to visit the playground. So we took him down there, 16 months old, for the first time. He got on that slide. He climbed the slide instead of the ladder. He went backwards up the slide. And when he got about halfway up, he slid down, got back up, went back up about three-fourths way, slid down. He was trying to hold himself up. About the fourth time, I eased up there next to the slide, and he was holding on to both sides of the slide. He's going up the slide. And I could hear him saying, keep going, keep going, keep going. He finally made it to the top. I told the church this morning, sometimes you just got to what? Keep going. You know what? You'll slide back down. But just turn around and do what? Keep going. Tell somebody next to you, just keep going. You'll make it. Amen. You're gonna make it all the way up to the top. Now, this morning, we had some old school church this morning. You know, and some of y'all know about that. Some of you don't, but it's in my blood. You know, you can't forget where you came from. Isaiah said, look to the rock. Look to the quarry from which you were digged out. And the kind of church I got saved in, you got fully saved. You said the prayer, you got in the water. And if you didn't come up saying something, you had to go back down again. But you're going to say something when you come out that water. We didn't get that little cute little prayer, okay. No, you had to go through all kind of things to be fully saved. And then, you know, back then, you couldn't even watch TV. Y'all don't know nothing about that. And the age I came up in, you had them rabbit ears on that TV with that little tinfoil on the side. Told my dad, I said, Dad, now that we're saved, we don't have to worry about the TV or the tinfoil. It's funny days. Y'all don't remember riding your bicycles? You put the little card on with the little clothes hanger in the front where it sounded like a motor. Till you wear it out, then you had to get a new deck of cards. I'm just checking y'all to see if y'all good. God is good. If you don't have Joel chapter 3 by now, look at the screen. Pastor Dustin, you are a great man of God, and we love you so much. And thank you for being a great leader. It's a real challenge pastoring in this day and age that you live in. It's not like it was in the 80s and 90s. Because back then, Jason, you remember, everybody wanted to go. Jason emptied Holmes High School and brought them to Family Praise Center. It was amazing how many people Jason brought to church. I still look back on that and think, good Lord, that boy had some influence. But back then, everybody wanted to go to church. Now you got to give them a cookie, you know, and a little milk and a little biscuit. And, you know, make sure everything's perfect. You got to have Disneyland for the children in the children's department. If it ain't Disneyland, they probably ain't coming back. It's an interesting day. So I commend you. You work, man. You never stop working. And no one talks to you more than I talk to you. And 95% of your conversation is about this church. That's how I know you love it. You can tell when a guy is done with his church. He don't talk about it no more. He started talking about football and everything else. Don't talk about it. That's all you talk about is Place for Life. And you are to be celebrated. We love you, Pastor Dustin, your family. Joel chapter 3, verse 18, and it shall come to pass in that day that the mountain shall drop down new wine, and the hill shall flow with milk, and all the rivers of Judah shall what? Flow with waters, and a fountain shall come forth of the house of the Lord. And they shall water the valley of Shittim. Isaiah chapter 2, verse 1. The word that Isaiah the son of Amos saw concerning Judah again and Jerusalem shall come to pass in the last days, that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains, shall be exalted above the hills, and all nations shall what? Flow unto it. And many people shall go and say, come. Let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. We'll take our text from the scripture in Joel chapter 3, verse 18, and all the rivers of Judah shall flow with waters, and a fountain shall come forth of the house of the Lord. I'm going to preach a message today entitled, Go and Grow with the Flow. Tell that to about four people around you. Go and grow with the flow. Now let's pray before you sit down. Father, I thank you now for the reading of your word. And I thank you that every person in this building was ordained to be at this appointed place at this appointed time. And no one is here by accident. I thank you for the word that you spoke to me concerning this particular hour, this day, this moment in time. And I ask you now to help me to articulate up under the anointing, the announcements you have for all of our lives. I pray, God, this is not some superficial dialogue where the words just fall to the ground and lie dormant. But I pray, God, that there would be a demonstration of your Spirit's power among us today, and that the words that are spoken from this pulpit will take light and land in all of our hearts and bring forth a lot of fruit. Father, we thank you that this is not a wasted effort nor wasted time, but this service counts. And we look to you even as the servants look to the hand of the master. And we say, Lord, speak, your servants are listening. Now, as a man of God, under the authority of the name of Jesus, I break every generational curse and dismiss every generational spirit. Have your way, Lord, in Jesus' name. Everyone say, praise the Lord. Clap your hands and shout to God one more time before you find your rest. Come on, everyone. Everyone, everyone, everyone. Bless the name of the Lord. Bless the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Praise the name of Jesus. 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 Amen. Go ahead and high five somebody and tell them you're in the right place today. And then you may be seated. When we began this series, and Pastor Dustin introduced to me the theme a few weeks ago, I was able to preach here. And I introduced you to three words: influence, confluence, and refluence. Those three words are very, very important. Influence comes from the word influx. It means something that flows from within or toward the inside. Influence suggests a certain persuasion that someone carries in their life. So if you're a person of influence, your words carry weight. Yeah. And when you lose influence, it's hard to get influence back. It takes two things to restore influence: time and favor. Okay, so influence, once removed, needs time and favor. Time goes on with or without your endorsement. But favor requires love from people. Then influence is restored. Confluence is different. You can have influence by yourself, but to have confluence, you need someone else with you. Because a confluence contains more than one tributary. It's more than one source flowing together. So it takes at least two. Two is powerful in Scripture. Tithe, offering, praise, worship, Aaron, her. These are modes and people of confluence. Paul and Timothy, two is better than one. One can put 1,000 to flight. Two can put 10,000 to flight. So it's very powerful when you add covenant partnership to your life. You can have authority by yourself, but to have dominion, you have to have somebody else involved. So if one can put 1,000 to flight, two can put 10,000 to flight, how many can all of us put to flight? So we've yet to understand the power of confluence that the prophet Isaiah prophesied in chapter 2 about, when he said that there would be people that would leave the house, they would go from the house, and they would say to people not in the house, come and go with me to the house. Then at that point, all nations will what? Flow together. The word nations is ethnos, ethnicities, more than one kind. It's very important that you understand the power of integration. God did not call you to live a separated, segregated life. The power of God is his diversity. We are not all the same. That is what makes us unique. If God created us all the same color and all the same kind, we would get bored very quickly. So therefore, it's necessary for us to come to a proper understanding of not just the color of a man's skin, but the culture from which he derived. Because until you understand his culture, you cannot assess his problems. Therefore, you have nothing to offer to him. And that does not mean that any color has suffered any more problems than any other color. Stay with me. When you track time, all colors have suffered at some point in their history. Oh man, you can scream and cry about racism, and racism is real. And I don't know of anyone that understands racism more than me. I was raised in a very racist area. And I want to say something to you concerning that. No one, no institution, don't let me personalize it, let me keep it corporate. No institution should be exemplifying nor exhibiting what integration really looks like more than the people and the house of God. And I leave that there. So what we need in our nation is a confluence. We need a confluence of mindset. We need a confluence of education. Quit trying to do it by yourself. Talk back to me. The last word I introduced to you was refluence. And I had a word I was going to preach on refluence, and you and I are going to develop it if you don't mind, Pastor D. But refluence is very powerful because it doesn't mean flowing together. It means flowing back. It's when the tide comes in. And the Lord spoke to me when I saw that word, and I shared it with you, that your flow is coming back to you. Let me say it again. Your flow is coming back to you. There's nothing more debilitating than trying to force life to happen. If it don't fit, don't force it. There's something very, let me use the right vocabulary, easy about flowing with people that are in agreement with you. It's a fight to try to get people on your same page. If you have to convince people to love you, then what have you gained? You've gained a bystander. And possibly a spectator. But I can tell you what you've not gained is a participant. And I don't know about you. I've got enough bystanders and spectators. I need some participants in my purpose. Listen, you don't have to tolerate people's opinion of you. And if they're tolerating your existence, you don't need their endorsement. You know all of that, don't you? You're smart. Influence, confluence, refluence. Is that right? That's the words that I introduced several weeks ago. Go and grow with the flow. It's very plain to me from Joel chapter 3, verse 18, and Isaiah chapter 2, that the flow started with a tribe, a particular people. The people are called Judah. Verse 18 of our text says, "And all the rivers of Judah shall flow with waters." Now, Judah is not only a people, it's a place, it's a region, it's a geographical area. Shall flow with waters. Now, let me say something to you. Judah means praise. It's hard to flow when praise is not going in front. Who will go up first for us? Judges chapter 1. Send Judah first because Judah knows how to create a flow. The reason you have praise in services is to create a flow in the service. But the praise does not belong to the praise team. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying to you? In other words, I've seen this in this church. I see it in churches everywhere I go. Praise team praising their heart out and people looking at the praise team like they're being entertained by a performance. That's not what church is. Church is not a spectator sport. Church is a participatory action. It's a participatory event. It's where we all get involved. The Bible says, "Praise the Lord, all ye people, and shout unto God with a voice of triumph." It doesn't say, "Praise team, get in position and start singing so we can watch you." That's why when I see people flood the altar during praise or move around during praise and worshiping the Lord and dancing, I love it because it tells me they are now actively participating. They're not being entertained, but they are participating in the act of praising God. And praise belongs in the sanctuary, not just in your living room. The Bible says, "Show forth his praise." So it's not a private matter. Oh, I'll just leave it there. I'm just seeing where you're at today. Go and grow with the flow. Now, flow is also known as the zone. Some of you basketball players know about that. Somebody gets hot. He's on your team, and what do you say? Feed him. Feed him. Because he's hot right now. Or we would say he's in the what? He's in the zone. Sam, you know about that. If he's in the zone, let the man shoot the ball. You know what? There's nothing more frustrating than that guy when he knows he's in the zone and nobody's passing him the ball. And you're just jogging up and down the court. And you know I'm in a zone right now. Please give me the ball. Y'all remember when Michael Jordan in that championship game just walked up into the huddle and said, don't worry about drawing the play? Remember when he said that? He said, just give me the ball. In other words, you guys can sit on the bench because I'm about to win this game. Tell your neighbor, I'm about to hit the zone. Yeah, amen. Now, it's the same way in life. Sometimes you're just hot in life. You're just in the zone. You're living life and things are just going good. Well, let me tell you what happens to basketball players when they get on the zone and they have an opposing coach. He knows they're in the zone. So we call it doubling down on him. Or boxing one, which means one guy is assigned to him all the time. Even when if he goes to the bench, walk over there and stand there and wait for him to get off the bench. You double team him because he's hot. So what I just told you is the enemy knows when you are in a zone in life. And he will send everything he can to shut you down. Because he don't want you to enjoy the flow like that. But I came by to tell you, when you're a real champion, you look at double teams and you say, bring it on. Because I'm fixing to school you and your twin. I need you to tell your neighbor, I'm about to hit that zone. Amen. I'm about to hit that zone. So it's being in the zone. Or it's the mental state of operation in which a person performing an activity is fully immersed. And he's feeling energized or a energized focus. When you're in a zone, basketball players know this. And Michael Jordan said, or one of the great basketball players said, it's like you're shooting a basketball and it looks like the basketball is a big pond. You can't miss. Can I just tell you, I believe that God is about to bring you into a sphere of your life. Watch. Where all your decisions are suddenly going to be accurate. Anybody in here tired of missing? You think you're in the right relationship only to find out this dude is jacked up. Or this girl half crazy and bent sideways. Don't you get tired of that? Don't you get tired of thinking you own to only find out you're off? Well, can I tell you, you're coming into a season in the next sphere of your life where wouldn't it be awesome if you knew you were going to make an accurate decision? Because God is going to lead you and guide you, and His Spirit is going to direct you. Can I get about 15 people to give Him praise because you know you're about to tell your neighbor, I'm about to hit the zone right now. I'm about to hit that flow. Okay. Pastor D, I'm not going to preach very much longer, but let me just say these words to you. There are three things concerning the flow. You need to write these down. Every flow has a source. Every flow has a source. Every flow has a course. And every flow has a force. Every flow has a source. Every flow has a course. And every flow has a force. Very important for you to understand that. So when you're in a flow, flow theory states that there are three conditions to be met to hit a flow state. This is good stuff. First of all, you must be involved in the activity to enjoy the flow. If you're not involved, don't expect the flow. So what I did is just polarize this congregation. Because there's only two kinds of people involved or in this congregation today. Those who are engaged in their purpose and those who are not. So if you're involved, you ought to be encouraged right now. So you must be involved in the activity and your goals must be clear or you will not enjoy progress. Second thing you must, in order to hit the flow state, the task at hand must have clear and immediate feedback. Boy, this is powerful. In other words, when you are in the flow, you need somebody telling you you're in the flow. That's what preachers get frustrated with when they're preaching and they know they're flowing and ain't nobody saying nothing. There's no immediate feedback. Has anyone ever told you something and it hit you immediately? You write about that. That is called immediate feedback. There's nothing like being on fire and your teammate telling you, brother, shoot the ball, man. Are you hearing me? You need great cheerleaders in your life. Let me help you. Surround yourself with people that believe in you. Some of you are wondering why you hitting and missing. It's not you, it's the people around you that's not telling you how good you really doing when you doing it. Now some of y'all saying, I don't need all that. Oh, there will be a day you will need it. You might not need it right now, but there will be a day you'll need just one person to say to you, man, you got it going on right now. And look, if you can't find them, give yourself immediate feedback. Because I'm here to tell you, ain't nobody a cheerleader like you a cheerleader for yourself. There ain't nobody know how to tell you you're doing good right now. I can't tell you the number of times I have gone to the mirror in my house by myself and looked at myself and said, Ricky, go on and do your thing, man. Because you ain't got her there to tell you. Some of y'all are lucky enough to be married. But when you by yourself, DJ don't speak English. He's a four-legged cane corso dog. He can't even smile right. But when I get down, I know how to look at myself and say, man, listen, you are in the zone right now. You flowing right now, brother. Let me tell you, that's why David said, bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that's within me. Bless his holy name. Sometimes you got to talk to yourself. So if you ain't got nobody else giving you feedback concerning your flow, give yourself some feedback. As a matter of fact, I dare you to put your hand on your chest and say, self, you about to hit the zone. You're doing good right now. If you wasn't, you wouldn't be in the house of God right now. So everything going to be all right. Tomorrow's going to be better than today. And the next day going to be better than that. Things is about to get better and better. Self, go ahead and smile. It don't matter what it look like right now. If you could see your future, you would be laughing because everything is about to change. You've been missing, but you're about to start hitting on something. To hit the flow, you must know the difference between perceived challenges and perceived skills. Did you hear me? To hit the flow, you must know the difference between perceived challenges versus perceived skills. Whew. Some of you have underestimated your ability to get over. Tell your neighbor, you better recognize. Listen, don't let where I am fool you. I do have the ability to get over the situation I'm facing right now. Oh my God. What does that produce? Confidence. I've noticed anything in the people of God is a lack of confidence. We act like we ain't sure. And let me tell you something. There ain't nothing more fun than playing basketball against a guy that's not sure of himself. I love that. Because the first thing I'm going to do is challenge your left hand. Because if you can't go left, you ain't got game. So I'm going to wear you out on your weakness. You better tell the devil I'm ambidextrous. You think you got me shut down on the left, I'm going to go right. And if you think you're going to shut down my right, I'm about to go left on you. Because you're not going to shut me down. When you in the zone, you can shoot it right or left-handed. Don't make you no difference. I'm preaching better to y'all than you talking back. My feedback ain't matching my flow. I ain't got to holler at you. When you in the flow, you ain't even got to lift your voice. I'm going to say it one more time. Your feedback ain't matching my flow right now. I'm trying to help you, to tell you you have more ability than you think you have.
How do you know that, Bishop? Because the Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The Bible says, you are more than a conqueror through him who gives you strength. The Bible says, you are above only and not beneath. The Bible says, you bless in the city and bless in the field. You bless when you come, you bless when you go. The Bible said, bump your neighbor and tell him, I know what I'm working with. I'm a bad something or other. Tell him. And when I hit my zone and I hit my flow, there's no stopping me. And all this hitting and missing is about to be over. I'm about to hit a zone, and when I do, I'm not coming out of it.
Amen. Amen. You may be seated. I think I'm going to preach. What time did the Spanish church start? 2 o'clock. Y'all reckon we run it up there till about 1:55, we'd be all right. Because I feel somebody trying to fight my flow, and I'm just going to sit here and overcome this thing. Your flow is about to become your overflow. Tell your neighbor, my flow is turning into a overflow, which means I don't have just enough to get over. I got more than enough. Some of y'all need to get that mindset out your head that you need just enough. No, God ain't never called you to operate with just enough. God said he will give you more. Jump on your feet and shout, Lord, give me an overflow. A flow that gets me over all my depression, gets me over all my situations. Come on, tell your neighbor, I'm about to go over. Every flow has a source. You may be seated. I don't think I'm going to get to the course or the force because I'm just taking my time this morning. I'm just with y'all's flow. You know, I'm flowing at your speed. Amen. I know how to flow. I'm a flowing brother. Some of y'all going to inbox me this week. Bishop Flo, what's happening? Rick, for every flow, there's a source. James 3:10. Out of the same mouth proceeds blessing and cursing. My brothers, these things ought not be. What's flowing out of you? James said, brothers, out of the same mouth is flowing blessing and cursing. Girl, what you doing back here? Y'all excuse me, when you get back? Hold on, having a family meeting when? A few weeks ago? Well, welcome home, girl. You come on in and just sit on the front row, don't you? All right. Where was I? Out of the same mouth flow blessing and cursing. Then the apostle says, now, brothers, this ought not be. Now, we told you that 2017 is the year of overcoming. And overcoming by the word of your testimony. And we also taught you that in Hebrew, the number 17 has to do with the region of the mouth, what you say. So James the apostle says, you can't be speaking blessing and cursing at the same time. Now let me go ahead and adjust your mouth for you. My daddy used to say like this, son, you better watch your mouth. Now I ain't finna tell y'all that, y'all grown people. but you better watch your mouth. Because your words form your world. It's important not only what you say, but how you say it. You ever seen anybody? One day you see them, they full of blessing, man. They just speaking blessing, 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 blessing. Next day you see them, boy, they cursing and cussing. Cursing is condescending about something, but I ain't gonna tell you what cussing is. I think y'all fully know. Verse 11 says, does a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter water? Every flow has a source. Does a fountain send forth at the same place sweet water and bitter? Can the fig tree, my brothers, bear olives? Either a vine figs? So can no fountain both yield salt water and fresh water? What is your source? I learned something. If you don't deal with the source, the symptoms ain't never gonna look different. See, here's where we masters. We masters at handling the symptoms. We masters at telling people, settle down, they settle down. But we never get to the root of the problem. So you can exist with it until it decides to manifest again. And it's gonna manifest again because the source ain't changing. Until you change the source, the symptom ain't never gonna change. Who's feeding you? Who's feeding you? Can I tell you a little story? Right out of the Bible. 2 Kings chapter 2, verse 19, there was a city. And the Bible says the men in that city said unto Elisha, behold, I pray, the situation of this city is pleasant, as my Lord sees, but the water is naught, and the ground barren. And the prophet said, bring me a new cruse and put salt in it. They brought it to him. And he went forth unto the source, the spring of the waters, and cast the salt in there, and said, thus saith the Lord, I have healed these waters. The salt didn't do it, I did it. Shoo! There shall not be from there any more death or barren land. So the waters were healed to this day according to the saying of Elisha the prophet, which he spake. Powerful. Can I just preach on the source and leave the course and the force for Tuesday? Thank you very much. The men of the city said, the situation, the NIV says, the town is well situated. The word situation is the placement in time. Powerful. It's pleasant. It means it's good, better, best, but not ready. Can I just say something to you prophetically? There's no reason why this church should not be packed. No reason. I'm going to say two words again. No reason. You're not going to find better music. You're not going to find people that love God more than we love God. I'm not talking about us. I'm talking about y'all. You're not going to find more kind people, hospitable people, giving people, caring people, loving people, energized people, enthusiastic people, anointed people, purposeful people. You're not going to find them anywhere. Are y'all in the building right now? And our church is healthy. This is a good, healthy, healthy church. But there's nothing more frustrating than for a seer to be able to realize something ought be that is not. Boy, I'm gonna get on your address to help you. I say address. The situation is pleasant. Don't make me get on something else. Watch your mouth. The potential is there. Everything is set. There's no reason for this, but we've located a problem. Everything is perfect. In the time we live in, there's no better place in time than for place for life to be existing right now. This city needs this church. This nation needs this church. But he says, we found a problem. The water is bad. The flow is failing. And when the flow fails, the future is jeopardized. When the flow fails, the future is jeopardized. Influence can start a flow, but confluence continues the flow. In other words, it don't really matter how good you preach and how much passion you pour out. It don't matter if you stand on that organ bench and preach. It don't matter if you jump them chairs. I done done it. I have been 35. It don't matter what you do to start it. Until they catch it. It's going to start and stop. It'll start on Sunday and end on Monday every week. Until you carry what he delivers. In other words, you can't get it on Sunday and Monday act like you ain't heard nothing. See, back in the day, Kelvin and Pops, we know this. We lived off the word from the pulpit. We didn't just hear the message. We wrote notes. We pasted them on our fridge. We put them on our bathroom mirror. One word of encouragement. We put it on our dashboard in our car. What is that? Carrying that word all week long. And if you carry it, you can't help but talk about it. The problem with this generation is we're not talking about out there. Out there, we're not talking about what's happening in here. It happens in here and we leave it here. That's not a flow. That's an event. Woo. Until we take it out there. Isaiah said they go from here to there. And then they create a flow back in here. I'm praying that the flow hits you so hard and you get caught up in the zone of your purpose to a degree that your mouth can't stay shut. Until what is going on in you is so contagious that when it gets on anybody that talks to you, they're going to be like, where in the world were you yesterday? And you tell them, I was at the house of God and I got ignited about my assignment in the earth. I'm so happy to be alive. And your whole workplace is depressed, but you smiling, you on fire. We have to influence the world, not the world influence us. Take this word and create a confluence in this society. The only reason God wants you to get caught up in the zone is for you to tell other people. I'm about done. So what he said is this, Pastor D, only one way to fix it. He said, the result of the water, the flow failing, is the ground is barren. Whew. I got to get back in shape. I'm going to preach this hard. Where the flow fails, the ground is barren.
So he says the water is bad and the ground is not producing anything. Where there's not a continual flow, there's no production. Why is it important for you to stay connected to the house of God? Because the word is like water. And it keeps you flowing. We have located the problem, but we don't know how to fix it. Watch what the prophet said. Now, this is going to rock some of y'all, and I'm glad. Hear what the prophet said. Bring me a new. Oh, I'd say nothing else. The prophet said, bring me a new cruise, suggesting something's wrong with the cruise you've been using. You know what God does when he wants to create flows? He starts bringing in new, and in order to bring in the new, he has to remove. See, you're not working when you're taking up space and you're not making a difference. Ooh, the leadership just tightened up. I felt the leadership. Woo. Y'all looking at each other like, ooh, somebody finna replace me? Ooh, Bishop. The only way to fix what's failing is to bring something new. The word new right there means fresh. Let me tell you something. There is nothing more stale than somebody who's been doing what they've been doing for a long time and they're not fresh. Do you know how long I've been preaching? Josh the rapper? 35 years. 35 years, that's a long time. I've been saved 35 years, been pastoring this church for almost 25 years. Do you think I've ever gone to the Dead Gum bookstore and bought me a sermon book and went home and printed it off and came over here and preached it to you? Let me help you with that question. The answer is not just no. Never. Because I know the God I serve. Don't need to give somebody else a message to put in a book for me to go find when he can talk to me all by himself. You got stale church because you got stale leaders. You got stale church because you got stale pastors. I don't care how big it is, if there ain't nothing flowing, if there ain't nothing moving, you just have a large community. I don't mean anybody is changing. Ooh. David said, I shall be anointed with fresh oil. You know what my prayer is every week? Lord, don't let people, I don't care if I'm in California, Miami, LA, Chicago, don't let me walk up there and bore people. And please, God, don't let them bore me. Because I can't stand to be in stale environments. I can't stand to be in stagnant atmospheres. I need something moving. I need something flowing. I need something fresh. I need something new. I need a right now word, not some word you paid for from a bookstore. So somebody ought to appreciate other people who actually study and pray to stay fresh. Ooh, Lord. He said, now put salt in it. I leave it alone. I better leave it alone. See, this is what the bishop, I've been looking for this day for 35 long years. You hear me? I love being the bishop. I love it. My churches that I oversee, I go in there and say what I want to say.
I love it. I love being where I'm at. Love it. Because I don't have to be up here every day administrate. I can come in here one time a week. Like my daddy used to say, and jerk the slack out your britches. See, that's the power of being a bishop. My daddy said, son, I'm about to jerk you by the nape of your neck. I knew what that meant. Y'all mad at me? You be all right. So, God is good, isn't he? So watch this. The prophet said, bring me a new, bring me fresh. And watch what he said. Put salt in it. Here's why he said that, Pastor D. Because what we love, we want to preserve. I'm going to say it again. What you love, you want to keep. See, if you really love your marriage, you're going to keep it fresh. Talk in the building, Bishop. Y'all getting quiet now because I'm about to get on your wedding ring. If you want the marriage fresh and new, you will preserve it by staying fresh and new. Brother, change your cologne. Girl, fix yourself up some other kind of way. I'm trying to help your marriage. The brothers ought to be really screaming right now. People wonder why marriages fail, because people let marriages get stale, stagnant. You wonder why people leave church, because your church is dead. People you have in leadership ain't bringing nothing fresh. Talk in the building, Bishop. So we preserve what we love. Salt is preservation. It preserves. Not only that, salt adds flavor. There ain't nothing worse than eating bland food. When you a Cajun like me, you need some seasoning on that thing, man. Don't bring me no bland gumbo. You like, man, if you see anybody in my house ask for the salt shaker, I get mad. I'm like, don't you touch the salt. Don't you touch no seasoning. We done put the seasoning in there. Now, them people from up north, they love that old bland food. They like, whoo, ain't got no salt, no seasoning, no Tony Sacheray, ain't got no. I want to taste some flavor. Are you understanding what I'm saying to you? And here's what the Lord's bringing back to his house, and I mean this prophetically. Not only freshness, he's bringing flavor back to the house. Flavor. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. We need flavor back in the house. Not the same old boring every time you come and eat. It tastes the same every time. This thing ought to, you don't season gumbo like you season gravy and rice. This place ought to be so full of diversity. Look around you. Everybody in here look different than you. Black, white, brown, yellow, little red. Every kind, every color, every culture. And you gonna tell me we supposed to be bored? You got to be kidding me. I told y'all before, I'm the brother that eats turnip greens on Monday and tacos on Tuesday. I'm that guy. I'm that guy. You can take me to Papacito's or Acadiana, baby. It don't matter. I'm gonna love them both the same. Because I like flavorful, different, diverse stuff. And God is about to shift this house
and bring freshness back to this place like you've never seen. That's why you've been preaching like a man from another world, because God has anointed you with a fresh anointing for this generation. You don't preach like nobody else preaches. Don't start now. Don't lose your passion. Don't lose your zeal. Jump on the organ. Jump on the chair. Run around the building. But always bring it fresh and always bring it flavorful, or leave it at the house. I wish I had about 30 people that is ready for a fresh, flavorful move of God in your life. To get on your feet and clap your hands and give him praise. God is about to adjust your source. God is about to adjust your origin. God is about to adjust your fountain. God is about to touch your spring. God is about to touch your spring. God is about to touch your source. Who's your source? Who is your source? The fountain tastes like the foundation. The source, the spring tastes like the source. The question is, who is your source? Complaining people, negative people, bad attitude people. Guess what's going to come out of you? That's why you need the house of God. Because when you come here, the source is so powerful that what comes out of here comes out of you. Amen. So I say, Lord, bring the flavor. And Lord, bring the freshness. And people that refuse to change, remove them. I pray now in the name of Jesus, Lord, people in this ministry that refuse to be fresh, remove them. People that do not preserve flavorful flows, remove them. Now, God, I pray that you release from the north, south, east, and west people that are looking for the fresh, people that are looking for something flavorful from your house. And I thank you, Lord God, that they're coming from all four corners of this community. In the name of Jesus. Some of y'all are in a very stale, stagnant area of your life right now. If that's you, you need to come up here right now, because God is about to touch you. You're going through a stagnant season. It seems like nothing is moving. Nothing's flowing. There's no flavor to life right now. If that's you, you need to come up here right now. You just feel like you're in a stagnant phase of life. Like nothing is moving and flowing for you. Please come right now. God is about to touch you. God is about to touch you. And God is about to release freshness to you. Even in your marriage, if your marriage is stale, you ought to bring your partner up here right now. You ought to bring your spouse. Single people, if you're going through a stagnant time of your life, you ought to be in this altar right now. Seems like everything's stale. Nothing is moving. Everything's stagnant. You should be in this altar right now. When you get here, lift your hands, please. Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Father, I pray that even as David was anointed with fresh oil, that you would touch every person in this altar, that you would bring a sense of freshness back to their life, that you would bring, Lord God, a sense of flavorfulness back to their life, where they enjoy living again and life becomes important to them again. Lord, you have come that we might have life and have life more abundantly, not just in quantity, but quality. And I thank you, God, you're bringing a quality life to every person in this altar today. You are touching every person in this altar that wants you, that's seeking you, that desires something fresh from you. And I pray, God, you touch the source today, that you will touch the source today, touch their spring, God. And I pray, God, that that spring become like a river flowing up out of them. Out of your belly shall flow rivers of living water. Lord, I pray that it'll begin to flow out of every person in this altar today. that you would touch them name by name and person by person. Father, I praise you and I glorify you. Everybody lift your hands all over the building. Pray after Pastor Rick. Say, dear Lord, I ask you to go to the source of my existence and fix me there. Don't remove the symptoms. Deal with the source. Fix me, Lord. Finally fix me. Touch the source in the name of Jesus. And I thank you, God, that you're adjusting the source. Help me to connect with my source, which is you and your house. I thank you, Lord, for connecting me to freshness and flavor in the name of Jesus. Lift those hands all over the building.